Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 4th January 2019. The articles we'll be seeing are these seven. First article is about China's lunar mission called as Chang'e 4. Second article is about National Rural Livelihood Mission of Rural Ministry. Third article is about India-Myanmar-Thailand Trilateral Highway. Fourth one is about a new report on child shelter homes in our country. Fifth article talks about the Amendment to Right to Education Act. Sixth article is about India and Afghanistan partnership, and the final one is about disability and the insurance benefit to them. The first article we'll be seeing is China's Chang'e 4 lunar rover. This article was taken from the paper Hindu. For the first time in the world, China has made successful soft landing on the moon's far side. Since the revolution of the moon is equivalent to rotation of the earth, only one side of moon will be constantly facing earth. So because of this, the scientific community's knowledge about the far side of the moon is very limited, and this probe has been sent to answer the unknown questions. This probe will throw light into formation and the early evolution of the whole solar system, and this will also conduct many first hand radio astronomy experiments using which evolution of earth and its radio noise can be decoded. Apart from that, this experiment will also conduct many first hand radio astronomy experiments on the farther side of moon, and it will also help us know whether plants can grow on moon. This probe consists of both lander as well as a rover, and the lander, it landed on the unexplored territory of moon's south pole Aitken Basin. This South Pole Aitken Basin, it contains a crater called as Von Karman Crater, and this Von Karman Crater is an impact crater which has been formed externally due to exogenic factors. However, one main problem in conducting experiments in the farther side of moon is that Earth cannot directly receive signals since the experiment is conducted in the farther side of moon. In order to overcome that limitation, signals are sent by using a relayed satellite. The name of the relayed satellite is QuAco, and this QuAco is placed in the Halo orbit. So this Halo orbit is located at about 40,000-50,000 miles beyond moon, which will communicate directly to Earth, and it is located at direct line of sight communication line. The next article we'll be seeing is National Rural Livelihood Mission. This article was taken from PIB. So the government of India, in order to promote skill development in our country, has brought in an umbrella scheme called as National Livelihood Mission. So this National Livelihood Mission has two main sub-branches, one for rural areas and the other for urban areas. So for the rural areas, it has National Rural Livelihood Mission under the name of Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana. The main function of the Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana is to offer institutional platform for skill development of the poor rural household. It's also a confluence of many other livelihood services such as production, financial and capital services, also offering market linkages, access to many entitlements, innovations, and also last mile public service delivery. So by providing these forms of institutional platform, it aims to aggregate as well as nurture self-help groups in the rural area. The National Rural Livelihood Mission also aims to organize one woman member from each household to form women self-help group in order to procure them with financial security. So the scheme also enables to offer these livelihood services by building enabling environment via various partnerships as well as convergence with other schemes. As one of the submissions of National Rural Livelihood Mission, the government has taken up promotion of organic farming with women self-help groups across the country. This not only provides alternative source of employment to the women self-help group employed in agriculture, but it is also a eco-friendly alternative for the normal way of agriculture. And another important submission under National Rural Livelihood Mission is Ajivika Gramin Express Yojana. So this program, it aims to provide safe, affordable as well as community monitored transport services. So the vehicles under this scheme will be owned by the community self-help groups, and it will operate in underserved and unserved rural areas. Thus, it will also enhance the last mile connectivity to untouched rural areas. Next important scheme under National Rural Livelihood Mission is Startup Village Entrepreneurship Program. So this program, which is implemented by the Rural Ministry, aims to create a successful ecosystem for supporting small businesses in rural areas. So this ecosystem components consists of providing mentorship, providing seed capital, training and capacity building on technical as well as marketing aspects for the rural entrepreneurs. The next article we'll be seeing is India-Myanmar-Thailand Trilateral Highway Project. This was also taken from PIB. This project, India-Myanmar-Thailand Trilateral Highway Project, is under construction. This highway, it connects India to Thailand via Myanmar. In India, it connects the town of Moray in Manipur to Mae Sot in Thailand. So this highway passes through Mandalay in Myanmar. So recently this project has received 191 crore from Indian government for its infrastructure development. Apart from Indian government support, Asian Development Bank also via its assistance under a project called as South Asian Sub-Regional Economic Cooperation and Road Connectivity Investment Program has also provided significant support for the development of this infrastructure project. And also Niti Aayog has created a special purpose vehicle to raise funds for supporting this trilateral highway. So India is undertaking the construction of two sections of this trilateral highway, which spans for about 1300 kilometers totally. The first section is Kaleva Yagi Road and the second section is Tamu Kigon Kaleva Road section, which is currently constructed by National Highway Authority of India. India, Thailand and Myanmar also plans to extend this connectivity to include countries like Laos, Cambodia and Vietnam, thereby increasing India and ASEAN links with regional comprehensive economic partnership agreement with ASEAN 10 countries plus 6 other countries in Indo-Pacific region under negotiation. Extending of this infrastructure projects to countries like Laos, Cambodia as well as Vietnam will give significant thrust to the trade potential under RCEP. This project will also increase the connectivity of northeastern region in India and it will also significantly contribute to the development of northeastern region in India. The next article we'll be seeing is Government Report Reveals Grim Horrors in Shelter Homes for Kids. This article was taken from Hindu. So a pan-India survey of childcare institutions was conducted by the center recently. The survey was conducted for the period 2015 to 2017 and the name of the survey is Mapping and Review Exercise for Childcare Institutions. This survey drew significant insights on the condition of the shelter homes for kids in our country. In few states of our country, there is increasing incidences of sexual harassment of the children in childcare institutions. So according to this report, there are about 3.5 lakhs children living in about 10,000 odd shelter homes in our country and significant number of them are in need of protection and care. And very important part of it is about 1,700 children in the shelter homes are victims of sexual abuse or pornography. They are also victims of trafficking as well as victims who have come out of the child marriage in the child care institutions. So these statistics, it shows poor safety and security measures taken in the childcare institutions in our country. And it also manifests the inadequate monitoring of the facilities by the required authorities and also lack of efforts put by the parents in order to trace the missing children who are sent to these homes. In the name of disciplining, the children are subjected to corporal punishment, given substandard food, and they are also left without any adequate medical as well as legal aid. So without proper education as well as skilled training, their capacity building is affected, which pushes them into cycle of poverty. So according to Juvenile Justice Act, which is in place in our country, the child care shelter homes should produce the children in conflict with law before child welfare committees or juvenile justice boards. However, more than 50% of the shelter homes do not produce their children before such juvenile boards. At these shelter homes, they do not have proper social audit and they do not submit any social investigation reports to the juvenile justice boards. Without proper child protection policy and financial audit report mechanisms, There is no significant way to increase the security and the safety measures taken in such institutions. The next article we'll be seeing is Rajya Sabha amends Right to Education Act scraps no detention policy. This article was taken from the paper Mint. So Rajya Sabha in its current session, it passed Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Amendment Bill 2019. So this right to education has been included as a part of fundamental rights in our country via 86th constitutional amendment in the year 2002. So this amendment, it included a new constitutional provision via Article 21A, which provided children of age group 6 to 14 free and compulsory education. To implement this provisions, Right to Education Act was put into force in the year 2005. And one of the important provision of this Right to Education Act is a no detention policy. This no detention policy, it prohibits the schools from detaining the students until they complete their elementary education. It also banned the practice of children repeating the class so that it can avoid dropout rate. However, this had an important negative effect on the quality of education offered by the schools. And because of this no detention policy, children did drop out after completing their elementary school. So this compromise made by the government to increase the enrollment rate did have a negative impact on the quality, which is clearly visible from the statistics released by Acer. So in order to overcome the shortcomings, the Rajya Sabha has recently amended this Right to Education Act. So after this amendment, states can choose to hold regular examinations either at the end of class 5 or class 8 or both in order to provide quality education to the children. The students who fail in this test will be given additional instruction there, and they will also be provided an opportunity to reappear in this examination. If the student do not pass the exam, then the state government is empowered to take required decision. However, it must be kept in mind that no child can be expelled from the school before the completion of the elementary education completely. Next article we'll be seeing is partnership with Afghanistan built on specific needs. This article was taken from Times of India. So India's developmental partnership with Afghanistan, it is broadly based on five pillars. The five pillars are capacity building, humanitarian assistance, economic development, infrastructure projects, and connectivity. In the domain of capacity building, India has offered various skill and training programs to Afghans in our country, and there's also a special scholarship scheme provided to Afghan nationals. Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation, it also provides significant administrative training to Afghans to strengthen the governance and the administration in Afghanistan. In the domain of humanitarian assistance, India has supplied almost 1.1 million metric tons of wheat to Afghanistan, and it has also helped in construction of Indira Gandhi Institute of Child Health, which is a multi-speciality hospital in Afghanistan. So Afghanistan being a landlocked country, India has taken significant steps to increase the connectivity of Afghanistan. So one such important initiative is building of Chabahar Port. And Chabahar Port, it aims to connect India with Afghanistan without using Pakistan. So apart from this, direct air freight corridor has also been established between India and Afghanistan since 2017. The final article for the day is disabled must get insurance benefit even when the parents are alive. This is a recent statement given by Supreme Court. About 2.2% of the people living in our country are disabled according to statistics of 2011 census. Targeted interventions are required for the upliftment of these people as they are most disadvantaged as well as marginalized communities in our country. The Sustainable Development Goal 2015 pledges to leave no one behind. So in order to achieve the goal, recognizing the dignity of human being is very much fundamental, and for that economic empowerment of the disabled people is necessary. So one of the way of economically empowering the disabled people is via insurance schemes. So however, there has been some barriers for the disabled people to receive the insurance amount. Supreme Court has recently removed those barriers by allowing the disabled child to get the insurance amount even when the parents or the guardians are alive, provided the proposal attains the age of 55. Okay, this measure of Supreme Court is in line with the national policy for persons with disability of Government of India in the year 2006. This policy recognizes the persons with disability as valuable human resources for the country, and it aims to create an enabling environment with equal opportunities, protection, as well as rights to ensure their full participation in the society.